positive and lines of fine surgeon. The medical profession needs him.
More about Dr. Gregory Lane to your eagle eye.
But if you want someone who's the most promising young surgeon ever came to this hospital?
Oh, I'd say he had a fine pair of hands. But his judgment's worried me lately.
Well, there's one sure way to check on his judgment. Well, see what he says about Grayson. Aren't you always telling me that anyone who agrees with you is a darn good doctor?
Ah, you're getting too smart for me. Go on, then.
Good morning, Mr. Grayson.
Well.
Mr. Grayson, it's as bad as I thought of. Mr. Grayson, our advice is an operation. A very delicate operation.
I understand.
I insist on the operation. See, I'm afraid of anything except going blind. We're going to send you to one of the best brain surgeons. Will you tell Dr. Lane I'll talk to him after his exam, Mr. Grayson?
I'm very grateful.
Never mind us, Mr. Grayson. We'd be pretty bad doctors if we didn't do everything humanly possible for you.
Finally. We both know that the final power of life and death is still in the hands of the great
human. Yes, Mr. Grayson, that doesn't change. Dr. Kelly was on the phone, sir.
Thank you.
Well, good luck. Hey,
thank you, Doctor.
Hello, Phil.
Well, how is the head of this gold brain palace today?
Oh, boy, fine. Mr. Paul Messenger, sir. The order in Fatal Kildare after this afternoon. Dr. Squires will show him the place and offer him a job. Have you seen anything clear about it yet?
No, I won't. But in justice to everybody, I'm going to do my best to make him accept.
That's more than generous, Leonard. You lose him, I know it'll be an awful blow to you.
Oh, it'll be an earthquake.
Well, since you're not going to take your own route, am I right? And I want to talk to you anyway. Let's go and dig our graves a little deeper with our teeth. Miss Parker?
Lunch.
Grant that, Molly Bird. If I don't drink at least one glass of milk a day, she'd hide my cigarettes. Yeah. I know it's good for me. But you, I hate the stuff.
Yeah.
What made you hesitate about Grayson, Jimmy?
Well, I wasn't sure.
What made you decide? My best thought. That's the one most important thing for a doctor to know. To face situations with nothing to lean on but what he's learned.
Yes, even in my short experience, there have been times where I've loved being cold.
Yes, you had to act like the Almighty, with life in one hand and death in the other. You had to do it, and you did. That's what I call being a born doctor.
Well, that's useless. Aren't you going to drink him up?
Oh, sure, sure. But don't try and change the subject, Jimmy. Jimmy, you'll make mistakes, but let them be your mistakes. Use your eyes, your heart, your brain, your instincts. Make up your mind,
and then go ahead.
Do you think I'll ever learn half what you know?
Yeah.
You have to begin where I leave off. And do you think you're being fair to me? To yourself? To the medical profession?
Well, what do you mean?
You haven't seen Dr. Lockberg in 2 months.
Why?
Because I'm a good doctor.
And I know what's the matter with me.
Cancer isn't necessarily hopeless.
Well, every time I intend to go to Lockberg, something important turns out.
Nothing is that important. Look, if I'm to finish any part of what you've started, you'll have to stay here and teach me as long as you can.
All right, Jimmy.
I'll call him this afternoon.
Come on. Well, I always want to be here 5 o'clock.
Why, you... Come on, drink him up.
Well, things people do for the sake of their health.
Don't think you can hide from me, Dr. James Kildare.
Look here, Molly Bird, this is my bedroom, and even the superintendent of nurses hasn't got any right to come barging
in. Oh, be quiet. Dr. Kildare, that's Morgan informs me. You practiced 1144 with a new suit of clothes from the Hospital Emergency Department.
Oh, yes, I did, but you see, Mr.
I see everything. Well, don't you worry.
I ordered that suit, Burns, as a public precaution.
A public precaution, my foot. But the man had nothing more contagious than a broken arm.
I personally examined that suit of clothes and found definite traces of leprosy.
Leprosy?
Leprosy. Bubonic plague, housemaid's knee, and a slight trace of Scandinavian hookworm.
Scandinavian hookworm, you fool.
Miss Eisenberg, there was a job waiting for if he had a good suit of clothes.
Let me guess, you haven't drunk the milk.
Molly, you know what else you can say about me? I'm a man of honor. I said I'd drink one glass of milk, and one glass of milk I drank. Give me my cigarettes, please.
And how is the bottle still full? You'll drink this glass of milk or no cigarettes today.
Now give me my cigarettes.
We're still in your pocket. I forgot to take them out this morning.
Oh, really, friend.
I have been trying for 25 years to force somebody to take care of himself. It's a little hard to break the habit.
If you can get along without me for a while, supposing I run up to have a doctor, Dr. Lane.
Yeah,
Grayson's in pretty bad shape. Let me know when Wayne wants to talk to him.
That's what I meant to do.
Then later in the afternoon, we're going for a drive in the country.
Well, how are you thinking to make sense of me, sir?
It'll do you a world of good.
Maybe.
I've ordered a nice big car, so the three of us will be comfortable.
Three of us?
Well, you and me and Nurse Mary Lamont.
Yeah, well, why not Mary Lamont? She isn't engaged to Dr. Lane, even if she did go out with him last week. What do you expect her to do? Die an old maid because you only get $20 a month?
I don't expect her to do anything of the sort. Dr. Gillespie, I guess it's pretty obvious to you how I feel about Mary Lamont, but I can't and I won't say anything to her about it. After all, $20 a month is $20 a month.
We're ready, Dr. Lane.
Good, let's go then. I want to see you after this operation.
Dr. Lane, a package arrived for me this morning. It contained a dozen pair of beautiful silk stockings.
Silk stockings?
Silk stockings. I've sent them back except for three things. I don't know who they came from. I guess who you sent them. Besides, they're also pretty.
I don't know, sir. But I'm ready to have dinner with you tonight.
All right, Greg. We'll celebrate a successful operation.
I need a successful operation.
Oh, it's only the fools who are talking. Anyone knows mortality and brain surgery is high.
Yeah, but you can't explain that to a dead patient.
Dr. Gillespie still believes in you. You're operating on his patient, aren't you?
I still believe in myself. But this time I've got to. We've got an operation to come on, Mr. Lamont. How are you feeling, Mr. Grayson? Sleeping. Make sure you're shut now. I'm going to do my best to fix you up as good as you. Dr. Jim.
Jimmy, do you have a cigarette?
Oh, Mary.
Please, Jimmy, give me a cigarette.
By the way, Dr. Gillespie, what's you and me? Dr. Maynard's in the gallery, and the operation was a success, but the patient died. Mary.
The sooner you want this.
Just off the assembly line this morning. 41 brand new layers. Thought of even things up in.
You mean about life and death? I didn't think about it that way. I just happened to come here.
My instincts were right. It's the best place you could have come to. This is what it's really all about.
Jimmy, Dr. Lane did everything he could. No one could have done anything, could he?
No one. See, Mary, I prescribed an operation. I knew he performed it. I also knew how slim and changeable. That's our job, and it's one of the hardest things we have to learn.
I have a plan, sir.
That's what people need. Pure, sweet air. Fill your lungs with. Open up your pores to the sunshine. What's the matter with you, Mary? You look as if you hadn't opened a pore for months.
I did surgery today under Dr. Lane.
Oh, Mary, that patient had one chance in 100 of the operation. One chance in a million of living without it.
You're absolutely right. I reported that fact to Crewe.
What did Dr. Crewe say?
What could he say? Too many people die.
Dr. Gillespie, Greg needs help. Dr. Lane.
You're right, Mary. Something ought to be done about it. Is anybody interested in where we're going? We're going to the Lassiter Institute, the university.
Oh, George, where did we meet Dr. Gillespie?
I suppose you told him why, too.
Marshall, I didn't know that.
Well, then I'll tell you. We're going to the Messenger Institute for Medical Research because I've got business there. And I'm taking you to the Eagle Rise.
Mr. Messenger, don't give me generosity. This building with the inspector and equipment is a shining example.
Now, listen, Egghead. The eminent and imposing Dr. Squires was known as Egghead in medical school, for reasons you're both too long to know.
Well, I'm not supposed to give you a suit for that, and I'm just the guy who can do it again.
Now, listen, here, Squires. We all know this is the finest institute in America, but cover the point.
Very well. The point is, I have a job for Dr. Kildare.
Job for me? Oh, if it hadn't been for me, it's taken him 2 hours to tell you that.
Dr. Kildare, Mr. Messenger feels that he owes to you his daughter's sanity. Perhaps I might. Yours was a remarkable instance of correct diagnosis and treatment. I congratulate you.
I'll tell him the job pays $500 a month.
$500 a month?
And you'll have a free hand here to pursue whatever it is that you choose.
And if you attend your knitting, when you're an old married man, you inherit Egghead's job. $20,000 a year.
I ain't any.
Well, why don't you say something? Don't stand there like a bump on a log.
Well, it's the sort of thing you dream about.
Dr. Gillespie, you knew all about this? That means you want me to take it?
Do I want
me
to take it?
Do you hear that again? These youngsters are hard to please. Show them the house and go to the job.
House? Oh, yes. Shall we go see it? I bought it some tea.
Tea? When I first knew him, he thought clean shirts were effeminate. Now he drinks tea.
It's Mr. Messenger's idea that a man does his best work when he's home surrounding by ideas. You think he would be happy here, Dr. Kildare?
Happy, well, he'd be crazy if he could.
You feel aroused, Jimmy.
It's your party, you know. I feel a little tired. I think I'll stay here and have a spot of tea with Dr. Squires. Maybe a crumpet or two.
Well, then, how am I doing?
If I had known differently, I would have thought you really wanted him to take the job.
This is the greatest opportunity Jimmy will ever have in his life. If he takes it, all I've planned will come tumbling down around my ears.
All jokes aside, Leonard, would you like a cup of tea? Suppose I'll get you a glass of milk.
Yeah, I'm so full of milk now, I'd be afraid to meet a cab.
Isn't it lovely?
It isn't true, this sort of thing, doesn't it?
But it is true. Everything will worry about you.
What?
Dr. Gillespie wants you to take it, doesn't he?
Does he?
He wouldn't bring it up the salary for another
man. Oh, right now, I'm not thinking about the money.
But you must think about it. It's your future, your whole life. Who was the one who took you to see his house? It was Dr. Gillespie, wasn't it?
Yes, Mary. He even talked about the future. That's what he said. I wish I knew what he was thinking.
Well, should we look at the living room?
Mary, you have to tell me tonight.
Just got a date. I'm going to ask the Jimmy.
Hey, break it up, you two.
But Dr. Gillespie, I think he'll be ready for you to move in, say, next Monday.
You're very kind, Dr. Squires. Mr. Messenger's generosity is tremendous, but I'm afraid I'll have to think it over and let you know.
Oh, of course, Dr. Kildare. Think it over.
Oh, welcome.
Hey, I think I'll take that milk now. Good evening, Dr. Kildare. You're a sight for sore eyes, and why shouldn't you be?
Sure, Theodore.
Yes, sir. Sure, and what more pleasant sight could there be than a fine young son of the old blue suit and his old teeth stepping up to buy himself a good thing?
Hi, Joe.
Wait a minute, Doc. It'll be $30 anyway you figure. I charge $52 for soup. It's got to get me my nickel for a cup of coffee. Sorry, I got it. When we get to the golden slipper, I just won't eat anything. That'll give me $1.60 margin. Golden slipper? Well, leave it. Don't eat until the charge there. $5 a head.
Huh?
$5 a head? Even for not eating? Boys, there must be some way out of this.
Julie, boy, maybe I can help you.
Is it think I can mix it and solve all your troubles? If it can only cost the lady a disciple. Wait a minute. Now, Dr. Kildare, I'm referring to a humble little concoction known as the kiss of Kilkenny. It don't make you drunk, and it don't make you dizzy. It leaves you with one consuming thought in your mind to sit quiet in your chair and listen to the angels sing.
Want to keep her sitting here all evening?
My friend back in County Donegal, I personally concocted one for a giddy young thing who wanted to pick up for a dance.
How long did it keep her quiet, Mike?
Resident, it was 13 years ago, come true to me. And according to a letter I received last week, she's still sitting there.
Say, I know this now, Mike. You fix up Tucker's work, and I'll be back here on a jumping with her.
What do you advise for dinner, Mike?
Well, I can fix your steak as fresh as a new policeman. Two steaks medium rare. Come on up. Two steaks medium rare for Dr. Kildare. Give him the tool we're saving
for the
bar. No, Mary. I'm
going
to let you know.
Sit down. All your mistakes.
We'll restart. Good. Mary, did I ever to tell you what my mother said to me when I left for New York.
Several things.
This one. Well, she said you will never get anywhere trying to be anybody but Jimmy Kildare.
Jimmy Kildare's all right with me.
Over the past hour, I've been trying to be someone else.
Why, Jim?
Because if I were someone else, maybe I'd have brains enough to say this in a different way.
Say it your own way.
I'm not going to pick the job at the Messenger Institute. Mr. Lamont, we've got the superintendent Bird's office right away.
Tony, if we had a patient in this hospital as weak as your copy, we'd give him a blood transfusion and send for his relatives. I don't blame the nurses for squawking. Nurses are just like husbands. You can abuse them, insult them, work them to death, jump all over them, take it, but give them a bad cup of coffee and you've got a revolution on your hands. Oh, come in, Mary. I'll be down to the kitchen in 10 minutes and show you how to make coffee. You sent for me, Miss Bird? Lamont, I'm promoting you to staff surgical nurse permanently. Wait a minute, it's not that big an honor.
I'm sorry, Miss Bird.
Of course, I'll have to be more careful about our rules. For instance, I know that you accepted some silk stockings for a member of my staff.
I'm sorry. I'll send them back.
Before I'll give you a promotion, I must know that you plan on staying with this institution. I guess I'll be here forever. Because I said you would not give this chance to a girl who's liable to quit her job to get married or something.
I'm not figuring out how to get married.
No, child. I don't know why I'm so silly. Well, I know. I wanted to add to Dr. Gillespie about Jimmy Kildare and the Messenger Institute. This can only mean that he didn't decide the way you wanted him to.
I kept hoping he didn't.
Oh. The only man in the world? It's not true, Mary. It's never true. Yet it were 9 out of 10 women in this world who never get married. And we women can be thankful that we fixed it that way. Because so many times, so pitifully many times, Cinderella can't rule her prince. And if there were not a man in the world for it, how would the Cinderella end up? Like me, Mary. I'm 49 years old, and what have I got in life? Bad coffee. No, give any woman a decent husband with a clean shave and a pretty good chance of getting on as well, and she'll come so close to thinking it's love that she'll fool him and herself.
I never thought about it like that.
Don't try thinking that way. And stop eating your heart out. Now get out of the house and get to bed. Report to surgery at 9 a.m. Good night. I said good night.
Good night, sir.
Mary, don't send back those stockings.
I can't.
I have one pair on. Hello? Superintendent Bird speaking. Beginning tomorrow morning, Nurse Mary Lamont starts a staff surgical nurse. Salary increase accordingly. She's to be assigned to Dr. Gregory Lane.
Is that you, Nancy Parker? I'm taking a bath.
If it's you, Mommy Brown,
not smoking a cigarette. Anyone else can go shoot themselves.
Me?
What do you mean?
Lodging at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning.
What do you think this is? A 6-day bicycle race?
It's only 10:15.
What do you want in the middle of the night?
I'm not going to take the messenger job.
Why, you unmitigated them?
Upstart.
Do you realize, Jimmy, you'll never have another opportunity like that as long as you
live? I'm staying here because I'm selfish. And since I was a kid, I know I wanted to be some kind of a doctor, but I didn't know what or where. Now I do know. I want to be a diagnostician, and you're the only one that can teach me.
Jimmy, I'm the happiest guy in the city. As a matter of fact, I've been sitting right here since 6 o'clock waiting for you to come in to tell me your decision.
Oh, sorry, I'm a little busy.
I'm too pleasant.
Well, I've got a note from Carew's office. Seems like you heard of my surgery, and you're to catch up right away. Do you mind if I borrow the...
No, take anything you want, Jimmy.
Yes, you've been raising change about that, too.
Yes, I'm starting tomorrow morning, assisting Dr. Lane. Well, perhaps I can arrange to have you transfer to someone else.
No, thanks.
So what's the matter with this fellow Lane, anyway?
I've heard he inherited a lot of money, and yet he wants to stick around in the skating rink.
No, that's not true. He's had money all his life, but he happens to want this matter.
He also happens to be interested in Mary Lamont.
Or I'll fire 3 or 4 of my best students
and Mary Lamont's business.
You have no regrets about that, Jim?
Nothing, Gillespie. If I told you once, I told you 5 times.
All right.
Don't bite my door. Furthermore, Dr. Gillespie, it's past your bedtime.
All right, Papa. I'll go to bed like a good boy,
and I'll be kind to dumb animals, and I'll wash people in the eaves.
So who do you think you are, Molly Bird and Long Pass?
Last night in the hospital emergency. Just a minute. Whoa. As I was saying, last night, two women in East Durham. Me and that new blue chiffon and Joe, I think he's actually an intoxicator. All of a sudden, I find I'm paralyzed from the waist down. No, I didn't touch a drop. Just one of those last bars lemonade in my client's place. But it was Joe Wayman runs. He would have said one word about me staying this evening.
I've got an emergency room.
Emergency one coming up.
Very simple. No identification. Nothing but a cane and $5 bill.